Pause the run, pause the run. All right, everybody, I'm running in the Beacons and they feel amazing. And my PF feels amazing. All right, but I don't wanna talk about them right now. I wanna talk about this coat. Basically, I have never purchased a winter running coat, ever. Like a coat that is specifically designed for runners. And listen, the technology has come a long ways since I was in high school, or even since I was in college at the University of Colorado, where we received free coats from the athletic department from Nike. But again, this is 10 to 15 years ago, and so the technology just wasn't there really. So coats have come a long way for runners, and basically I overdressed today, and so I'm kind of burning up in this REI coat that I have on now. And so I just mentioned this to let you know that I'm doing a lot of research right now on winter running gear, outerwear for runners in the winter. So it's coming, these videos are coming, stay tuned. But bottom line, this is not the right coat to wear for running in the winter. I'm just too hot and it's not breathable and all that good stuff. All right, just wanted to mention that. All right, let's finish the run. Woo, what a day, YouTube. Come on, run. The sun is setting rapidly, squeezed the run in, got it done. In the Beacons, feeling good, stretching now, eating popcorn, watching our Denver Broncos. We love our Broncos. And yes, I'm a big runner, but I also enjoy taking in a little football at times. And not the soccer version, the real American football, if you know what I mean. If you know what I mean. I'm kidding to all the European viewers out there and everyone else around the world. I know you love your soccer and your football. Football. Nice to relax. Just sit down, take a load off. Oh, these children. Dinner time. Oh, by the way, the Broncos won. They beat the Steelers. Sorry, woo! Pittsburgh fans. All right, true love, what are we cooking tonight?
We've got homemade autumn squash stew.
Uh-huh.
Well, just whatever, butternut squash stew.
Yep.
Whatever squash your store had.
And some amazing
and crusty bread.
Heyo.
With some good butter over here. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I'm gonna butter this and then I'm gonna immerse in that with the cream, so that'll be fun to watch.
Fun, okay. Butternut squash soup. on a cold winter night. Well, it's not quite winter yet, but...
Did it snow this last night?
Yeah, it did snow last night. Oh, butter my bread, butter my bread.
Butter my bread, butter my bread.
Someday, we're going to make some merch, t-shirts, and probably the first one for the channel is going to have to be butter my bread,
butter my bread, butter my bread.
Cheers, YouTube. Cheers. Oh, delicious hot soup on a cold night. Delicious hot tea on a cold night. Does it get better? Yes, I submit that it does not.
Mm-mm-mm.
Okay, let's revisit yesterday's vlog where I asked you guys to share some ideas for running shoe companies that maybe are not as well known, and you are rocking it. I am about to go inside and reply to all of your comments. There's at least 100 comments, and it's amazing. So here's a couple that you guys mentioned, which, by the way, my idea, Innovate, I didn't realize that's what they were going for, I-N-O-V-8. I'm not very good at riddles. Innovate. Thank you for whoever taught me what that actually stands for. I'm not sure if that's the best marketing and branding, but we'll leave that for another day. Okay, here are a few running companies that you mentioned from yesterday. On, or O-N, from Switzerland, I believe. O-N, and a lot of people mentioned them, and they are on my radar. And they're made by the Swiss, so it must be well-engineered, I would hope. Okay, next, Salming, which is from Sweden. Salming, S-A-L-M-I-N-G. Another company, Feet, F-E-E-T, Feet. Hey, keep it simple. Another company, 361 Degrees. Hello, have you ever heard of that? So anyway, that's just a few of the companies that you mentioned. But tonight, we are not talking about any of them. We are talking about a big dog, the New Balance. And did you know that New Balance was launched in 1906? And they started in Boston. And yes, Boston is the key word of the day. And so they started in Boston in 1906, not as a running shoe company, but rather as an arch support company, which is why when you go into a New Balance running shoe store now, they usually measure your feet, see if your arches are collapsing, and just try to help out with pronation and all that. So anyway, that's your little history lesson of the day. But yes, that is the key word of the day, Boston, because New Balance, their headquarters are in Boston. And today we're talking about the New Balance Beacon. Here is my full review of the New Balance Beacon. These are my thoughts on how it has performed after 50 miles. Now, the only category that I will not be able to critique or to talk about is durability, because I've only put 50 miles into them. I would say that for almost any shoe, you need to put probably 150, more like 200 miles into the shoe to really start to see the breakdown. But I will make a prediction. I think this shoe will get no more than 200 miles where you're going to get the full benefit of the fresh foam through the midsole. So that's my prediction, but just keep in mind, I've only put 50 miles. But for the ride and the upper and the midsole and all that, I think I can give you my full thoughts right now. Let's start with the upper. We got this knit upper here. Very comfortable. Very comfortable. I would say it has a slipper feel. It has a slipper feel when you put your foot in. It does not feel like a Salomon. It doesn't feel like an Asics. It's got more of that slipper feel in this Beacon. However, a little critique of the upper is that locking your foot down is a little bit of a challenge because this upper has quite a bit of flex to it, a little bit of flexibility. So locking your foot down kind of snug, which I actually do prefer a snug fit in through the upper. It's not a sloppy, you know how when you put like Adidas, some of their Ultra Boost shoes, the upper feels a little sloppy, like you're just kind of swimming around in above your foot. This does not have that feel, but I will say that locking it down is a little bit of a challenge. Now, I do also have a concern about the shoelacing eyelets right here. See the shoelacing eyelets? I don't know if they're going to last. It looks like they're already breaking down, and I've only worn the shoes probably, you know, 10 times. And so I'm a little concerned about the eyelets which you put the shoelaces through. If they break, you're kind of up the river, if you know what I mean. If you know what I mean. And let's talk about the midsole. Here we go. The midsole is frankly probably the most important part of any shoe because that's what gives you the support, the cushion. It's the overall ride that you get in a shoe and what your foot is experiencing as you roll over the pavement, roll over the dirt. And New Balance is so famous now for their fresh foam through the midsole. This shoe weighs 7.5 ounces, so it is very lightweight. One of the reasons I love it so much for recovery days is because you don't feel like you're lugging a lot of weight around. In fact, it is so lightweight, you could potentially race in this shoe in a 10K. Just saying. So I have just noticed after 50 miles that they're starting to show signs of a little bit of compression through the midsole. Nothing to worry about too much. We'll see where the shoe is at let's say 150 miles, another 100. But I am starting to notice just a little bit of compression after 50 miles. Compared to the Vaporfly 4% from Nike, where the midsole on the 4% is just, it's starting to compress a ton. It's like breaking down a ton already after only 40 miles. And then also through the midsole, you've got a 6 millimeter drop from heel to toe. I like that 6 millimeter drop a lot. I do. Lastly, on the outsole, so the bottom of the shoe, you can see it here and not too bad. Maybe a little bit of wear and tear underneath my first and second metatarsal. So the outside of the forefoot of my foot and just a little bit of wear and tear, nothing too bad. I kind of like what New Balance has done here in the Beacon with this rubber under your big toe and then also under the outside of your heel, just to provide a little bit of extra protection for your foot, but also for the durability of the outsole. Because if this rubber was not here, and the reason they placed it here and up here is because this is where a lot of runners wear out their shoes on the outsoles. So there's my breakdown of what the shoe looks like after 50 miles and how I feel in the shoe after 50 miles. But let's get to the good stuff. Why will I buy the Beacon moving forward? And I phrase the question that way because guess what? I'm gonna buy this shoe moving forward. I'm not saying this is my most favorite shoe of 2018, but it's definitely in the top three. And that is saying a lot because I run in a lot of different types of shoes. I will buy this shoe again. A, for comfort. B, for the weight. And I'm just rattling this off the top of my head based on my experience today and over the last 50 miles. A for comfort, B for the weight, C for the ride. Like, it's just a really nice ride that has cushion, but not too much cushion. You know what I mean? You picking up what I'm putting down? And how will I use this shoe moving forward? 3 to 8 mile easy runs. Some people have mentioned that they have raced half marathons and marathons in the Beacon. That blows me away a little bit because, wow, you must have really, like, strong legs. My legs would get a little too tired, I think, running in this shoe for over 10 miles. So for me, how I will use this shoe moving forward is on pavement and concrete for recovery days in that 3 to 8 mile range. And it's a beautiful shoe for that specific distance. And I would say even on that specific surface, yes, you can take it out on the dirt and on the trails, but it's gonna do better on pavement and concrete. One last thought. I'm trying to sell this shoe to you because I love it that much. How do you determine whether or not you should buy a shoe again? And maybe that's the question of the day. Maybe, we'll see, I'll come back to that. If you are struggling to get your butt out the door because you're tired and you don't wanna go for a run that day, you're just like sluggish, how do you feel at the beginning of the run and how do you feel at the end of the run? Today, if you'll notice on my Strava splits from today's run, I started off probably at 9 minute pace for 2 to 3 miles. By the end of the run, I think I was going about 7:20 to 7:30 pace. I slowly felt better as the run went on. It was a 7 mile run. And why did I speed up? Because I was becoming more limber, more loose, more loosey-goosey. I did not feel like I was carrying a bunch of weight around. Therefore, that is one way you might want to think about buying shoes moving forward is how do you feel at the beginning of the run compared to how do you feel at the end of the run, particularly when you are tired. All right, so that's just a tip of the day for you. And the question of the day, is the Beacon on your radar for a shoe to purchase? If it is, let me know why. If it isn't, that's okay too. There's a lot of shoes out there. I get it. A lot of small companies, big companies like these guys. And if you can't answer that question, I would actually be curious to hear, what is one of the determining factors that you use for repeat customers? Like going back to a shoe that you love. In fact, a couple people have mentioned, I think it was some Hoka shoes, like they've bought 10 pairs of the same shoe because they love it so much. So like, what do those factors look like for you in your purchases? Ladies and gentlemen, that is it. Thank you for being here for this Beacon review. And I'm gonna rank my top shoes of 2018. I guarantee you this guy's gonna make the podium. Guarantee you. All right, you know what time it is. Seek beauty, work hard, and love each other. We will be back tomorrow.